For this last section of chapter 15, we will describe various factors affecting the solubility of insoluble salts. The first one that we discuss is a review of the common ion effect. If you remember, we first discussed this when we introduced the idea of buffers. Remember that by adding a common ion, we're simply shifting the equilibrium of a system. And the same thing will happen when we're working with an insoluble salt. So our first question here, we want to determine what will happen if we add solid sodium fluoride to a solution of saturated calcium fluoride. So again, recognize, as we discussed with buffers, that if I were to combine these two solutions, they're not going to react with each other because I would just get the same products. So there's no reaction that takes place here. All that's happening is when we add the sodium fluoride, we're adding an ion in common that will shift our equilibrium. So calcium fluoride is the insoluble salt. Again, that sets up equilibrium as it dissociates into calcium and fluoride ions. However, when we do add sodium fluoride to water, that is a completely soluble salt. So that will immediately dissociate into sodium and fluoride ions. We know sodium is neutral. It's not in common with anything in here. But in effect, what we're doing is increasing the concentration of the fluoride ion in solution. So as we add more fluoride to this solution, realize that fluoride's on the product side. That's going to force our equilibrium to shift to the left. And after this equilibrium shifts to the left, notice the way that we've written our equation here, we will get more or some precipitate of solid. So in this scenario, we were told it was just saturated. So that means we would just see the precipitation of the solid. So the net result, what will always happen, whether we get precipitate or not, we are always shifting our equilibrium back to the left when we add a common ion. And we are decreasing the solubility of the insoluble salt. So our question down here, how does adding a common ion affect the solubility of the solid? What is common in every case is that adding that common ion will decrease the solubility of the solid or the insoluble salt and increase or form solid precipitate. I know we've talked about shortcuts so that we can avoid using ice tables. However, anytime you're working a common ion problem, I highly recommend using an ice table. It's easier to keep track of where everything goes and how you're going to set up your solution. So for our practice calculation on this one, we are going to calculate the molar solubility of calcium fluoride in pure water. Working through our steps here, we have our dissociation equation, the same as we had on the previous slide. We would write our equilibrium expression. Concentration of calcium is first order, fluoride is second order, and since this salt dissociates in a 1:2 ratio, we know that this is going to solve down to be 4x cubed. And we are given a KSP value. So we do know that 4x cubed as our KSP will equal 3.4 times 10 to the minus 11. When you solve this down, we get an x value of, I'm going to solve it so that I have extra digits so that I can, oh, actually I don't need it for the next one. So solving for sig figs, we get 2 sig figs from our KSP. This one has a molar solubility of 2.0 times 10 to the minus 4. Example 15.12 is a great practice one for working common ions with insoluble salts. And our next step now is to now solve the molar solubility once we add the common ion. So again, here for reference is our original solubility just of the salt. But now we want to look at the solubility once we add the sodium fluoride. So again, for this problem, I am going to set up an ice table. Of course, our solid won't be included, doesn't matter. And the reason I want to set up an ice table is because I'm going to use this value as the initial for whatever my common ion is. Since fluoride's in common with both of those, I'm going to use that as my initial concentration. And realize, of course, that because it's starting with sodium fluoride, that dissociates in a 1-to-1 ratio. And so that's how I know that the initial concentration of fluoride is 0.010. The 2 as the coefficient of here is just for calcium fluoride. And so I'm looking at this concentration of fluoride as my initial. So calcium starts at 0. Calcium is going to increase by x. Fluoride is going to increase by 2x. And so notice at equilibrium for fluoride, I have 0.010 plus 2x. This is the hard part to figure out without an ice table. Not impossible, but just harder. And so now when we plug everything into our equilibrium expression, we get this setup. Remember again, the fluoride is squared. And since we're talking about the same salt as above, we have the same KSP value listed here. That is a minus 11, by the way. So looks kind of ugly, right? We have a lot of stuff going on in here that's squared, but remember our rule for shortcuts. We have a very small K value. Remember that when K is less than 10 to the minus 3, we can assume that any X that is added to or subtracted from a number can go to 0. And so even though we have a 2X here, I'm going to take that X out as a 0 because it's added to or subtracted from a number. And so when I do that, that simplifies our math greatly. So that's going to leave us with X. I'm only going to have the quantity of 0.010 squared, and all of that is going to be equal to my KSP value, 3.4 times 10 to the minus 11. And so now I'm dividing both sides by this 0.010 squared. When I do that, I get a final X value of 3.4 times 10 to the minus 7 molar. And so again, comparing, without the common ion, our initial solubility was 2.0 times 10 to the minus 4 molar. Once we've added the common ion, that shifted our equilibrium back toward the left, back toward the solid, decreasing the solubility. Notice that the amount of dissolved ions in solution is much lower than it was before. And so you should always predict with a common ion that your solubility will decrease.